Hey folks, Alan Manick the Hot Rod Hippie here. This week's video is coming to you by viewer request. We are doing some
heliforming.
So let's get to it. Alright folks, on today's video we're going to be doing hammer forming again. This time we're going to create a speed blister. So what is a speed blister? Well, it's not just the thing that pops up in your hand while you're hammering a whole bunch. No, a speed blister is a clearance part. You'll use it to create domes, to create shapes you need to create clearance, cap off tanks. There's a lot of different uses you could probably come up with for a speed blister. Just look for a domed part. And this is the same concept that you're going to be creating. You know, last time I created a speed blister for a project in the shop was to create clearance for a rag joint on a steering column. That part on a 63 Galaxy was a weird component, and that speed blister fit the need perfectly to create a nice clearance around that rag joint so it could spin smoothly and create the clearance, but seal off the firewall from the engine bay. So the speed blister we're creating today is going to be out of 3003 aluminum, 18 gauge thickness, and it's going to be a round speed blister. Nice and simple, round, straightforward design. The hammer form I'm using is this 3/4 inch plywood one I made quite some time ago. I used this one on that Galaxy project. It's 3/4 plywood stacked together and wood glued together. There's also a top plate here that screws on, and that is the clamp plate that the material will go between that and the main hammer form. Now you see, there's no bottom to this. You know, as with my last hammer forming video, we were hammering the material onto the form to both create it and kind of finish it at the same time. On this one, we're gonna flow form, meaning we're gonna push the material down into here, stretch it into this piece, and then we'll finish it by taking it out and hammering it over dollies. Now, that's a point to note here. The last hammer forming video I did, that was all shrinking. The entire time I was creating that tank end cap, it was all shrinking the material. This one is all stretching. We're gonna be stretching the material out. So you do need to think about that in your material thickness choice. I'm working with 18 gauge aluminum here. 16 gauge aluminum may not be a bad choice, because as I stretch this, I'm aiming to create a big dome to really show you what I'm doing here. It's gonna stretch that material a fair bit. That 4 Galaxy one that I created, that was 20 gauge steel when I started, and at the fully stretched out dome shape, it was more like 22, 23 gauge. Since it wasn't a structural component, it didn't really matter, but it definitely thinned that part down. If you were looking to add some structure to something with this dome, that would be a little thin for that purpose. So to start this project, we're gonna use my Ron Fournier Enterprises blocking hammers. To create this form, all I did was use a hole saw and cut each individual layer of the plywood, line up the hole, stack it together, and wood glue it together. Done. Simple hammer form, really quick and easy process. On the clamp layer, the top layer, I do chamfer that opening all the way around so that when I'm hammering into the form, I can get the hammer at a lower angle to the piece. So if I need to get tighter to the edge, I can do that thanks to that chamfer. If I didn't have that chamfer, it would block me a little bit from hammering away on the piece. Okay, to get started on this project, we're gonna go ahead and transfer the circle to the actual blank piece that I'm gonna be using to create this shape. Our end goal is a round speed blister. If you take this square piece and you pound a round hole into the center of it, there's gonna be additional material outside of that hole in various areas. Say these corners will have quite a bit more material at the outside edge than the sides will. That material is gonna have to work harder to pull material from the outside edge into this speed blister. So I like, when I'm creating a round one, to just create a round blank to start with. You also need to note, you need enough material around the outside of that round blank so that you have material to work with. Now the speed blister we're gonna be creating is a 5-inch speed blister. So I'm gonna aim for something around 7 inches, 7.5 inches for my blank circle to work with. Now it just so happened I had this scrap circle lying around that was the right size for this piece, but you know, you can use a compass, you can use a lot of different circle templates to go ahead and create your blank round circle. Alright, now I got my blank circle cut out. So now I just gotta go ahead and locate my blank onto my hammer form. I've already marked out the 7.5 inch circle on the hammer form so I know right where to put this piece so that it's centered. Now I'm gonna go ahead and put the clamp plate back on, trying not to move my blank around while I do so. All right, now I've got my blank in there, ready to start hammer forming this piece. So I'm gonna go ahead and clamp it down to the table and get to hammering. Okay, so now that I got this piece clamped down, I'm ready to start hammering. I'm gonna use my blocking hammer, as I said, and I'm gonna start dead middle of this piece, because that's where the highest dome is, so I might as well start there and work my way out to the outside edge. I'm not just gonna keep striking in the middle and hoping it's gonna pull all the material down around. I need to work my way around this dome so I can create a uniform stretch and a uniform float-in piece. If you focus too much on one area, you're gonna overwork one area and you're not gonna get a good consistent dome like you're aiming for. Now, a nice thing with this is you can kind of course correct as you go. If you realize that you're overworking one area, but not quite enough of another area, then you can focus on that area you're not hitting as much. You'll figure out the actual fine mechanics of it as you do it. It does take practice to get a good finished product. Now, it might be hard to make out, but there's actually some areas around the outside edge of this that aren't as finished off as I might like for the edge. Here's where that chamfer really comes in handy when I'm working my way around this edge to get nice and tight low angles. All right, so now I have my roughed out shape here. My dished bowl has been created. You can see from the other side, it's got that shape that I'm looking for. It's just got a whole lot of little hammer marks. Kind of looks like a Jamaican steel drum. I do have a little tear. I went too far with this. I was aiming to create a really deep dish for you folks because I really wanted to show you what you can do with this. So I should have annealed this piece before I started, and I probably shouldn't have domed it as much as I did. I'm gonna try and finish this part off anyway, see if I can work with it. You know, if you got a tear like that, obviously material is getting a little thin, but you might be able to finish it and weld that section back up and finish it off. More than likely, if it was me, I would go ahead and scrap this piece and make another one, and I may yet do that for the finished product in this video. One more thing I should note before I pull this out of the form is something you should think about before you pull it out of the form, and that is you want to have your finished depth right now. Do not think you're going to pull this out of here and put it back into the form and get more shape out of it. I have made that mistake before. It doesn't really work. When you pull this piece out and you start to finish it off, hammer it over a dolly or use the planishing hammer on it, it will stretch just a little bit. It will grow just a little bit. So when you try to put it back into the form, it may well not fit into the form anymore. So I really recommend get the depth, the shape that you want the first time. Aim for it, measure it. If you need a certain clearance, you need a certain depth, measure and make sure you're getting it before you pull it out of here to finish the part off. And there's my little flying saucer, my little World War I helmet. Now for my finish work, I'm going to use this dolly here. This is a post dolly that I picked up off eBay some years ago. It's meant for blacksmithing, but I had to sand it quite a bit to get the old casting marks out of it, and now it's ready to be used as an actual hammering dolly for finished work. So obviously with its domed shape, it's really gonna help me to go ahead and dolly this piece to back it up for smoothing out really nicely. I'm gonna start the finishing process with a leather face slapper so I'm not overworking the material to begin with. So as I'm working the piece, I'm feeling around, I'm looking around for low spots, areas that need to be brought up a little bit. And what I'll do is if I see a low spot, I'll make sure to focus the dolly right behind that area and I'll strike around the low spot to bring the low spot up. It's called metal bumping. It's this basic concept when you're doing dent repair as well as metal shaping. So now that I have the whole thing bumped out to where I'm pretty happy with it, I'm gonna go ahead and move over to the metal slapper and the body hammer to get a more finished look. We'll work on the flange, and then I'll sand it for a finished product. right, so about a half an hour later, this thing is to the point where I'm pretty happy with the finish on it. It was pretty tiresome work. Usually when I would do this, I would go over to the planishing hammer and I would give this a quick planish. In a matter of moments, I would be done to a nice smooth finish that I could sand and call complete. This obviously working completely by hand because I wanted to show you that this can be done by hand without fancy tools. Well, then I'm getting a pretty good finish on this too. A little more time into it, I'd get an even better finish. I'm gonna go ahead and sand this. I'm gonna polish it up real quick and show you what the finished product looks like. Then we'll go over what we saw here today. All right, so a little bit of elbow grease later and I've got a finished up, polished up speed blister. Handy little part. It's got a nice flange on there so I can drill it and bolt it onto a panel so I can have an access cover. I could solid rivet it on for that nice aircraft style look. I could wear it as a silly Halloween costume, whatever the heck you want to do with this thing. It's a neat little operation and it's something you should probably practice. It's a good skill to have because the principle applies to a lot of different facets of metal shaping. It brings together a lot of functions. Stretching, finishing, getting a nice finished flat result. You practice doing this and it really will translate to all your other operations, I promise you. You're also not just limited to this round shape. Here's a triangular shaped one I made in the past, a teardrop shaped one I've made. So you can really use this operation, the same principle, in a lot of different ways. Your imagination and the stretchiness of the material are your limits when it comes to this. Like I said, with that split that I got in this piece, now that it's polished up, I can barely tell where it is. But if I was making a finished component, I would have stopped as soon as that split happened, and I would have started fresh with a new piece. To avoid that split, I should have annealed this part before I started so it was in a dead soft condition. So that might have helped it stretch and give a little bit better. And I probably should have used a thicker piece, maybe 16 gauge, if I wanted to go this deep. I went deeper than I normally would have on this part because I really wanted to show you for the camera to pick up what I was doing and see what I was creating. So I hope you've seen here, you can really create some complex shapes by hand. All I did was use hand tools to create this. Piece of wood, piece of metal, some hammers, some dollies, and I've got a neat complex component. You can really do a lot with hand tools. The big fancy expensive machines, we all want them, but at the end of the day, all they do is make the work go quicker. They don't make the work better, they just make it quicker. When it comes to the English wheel, the planishing hammer, the power hammer, you can do pretty much everything that those machines do by hand with simple hand tools. It'll just take you a very long time. The finishing operation on this, I could have gone farther. I probably should have gone farther for a finished component. I would like to see it a little bit better than this, and it still took me about half an hour, close to 45 minutes to get this finished up. A planishing hammer, I would have gotten a better result in minutes, less than a tenth of the time that it took me to do this piece. All right, folks, I hope you found this video informative. If you did, drop it a like. Let me know in the comments down below. Is this something you have already been doing? Is it something you think you're gonna start doing now? Would you like to see another hammer forming video about a little bit more complex and usable components? Let me know in the comments down below. Subscribe to the channel for more content like this every week. Thanks for coming around, folks. Lost my clamp.